But one of God's signatures is often he adds and multiplies to our destiny first by subtracting. That's God's word for somebody. Maybe God has to delete some of your Facebook friends. Sometimes God has to remove some followers off your Instagram page because he's trying to multiply you. And let me tell you, this woman dealt with subtraction not because she's been disloyal, not because she's unrighteous. And let me tell you, sometimes God, who he loves, he subtracts. Sometimes God has a pair of divine scissors in his hand and he says, I want the best out of you, and so I can get the best out of you, I first have to cut some stuff away. You don't believe me? John 15, he says, if you abide in me and I abide in you, he says, I want you to produce fruit. And he says, the person who produces fruit, he says, I cut on them. I cut on them. I don't cut on them to hurt you. I don't cut on you because I dislike you, but I cut on your life. I cut some people away. I cut in some circumstances so you can bear much fruit. Look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, God may be cutting on you, but he's not trying to hurt you. He's trying to get more out of you.
That's it, God. That's it. That's it. That's it, brother.
Secondly, tonight,
walk with
we have
it,
to
Reverend.
Receive prophetic instruction. Look, this woman
walk
it, tonight. The woman realized she's in desperate need of wisdom that she does not possess. And she calls on the man of God for assistance. May I be pastoral for a moment tonight? We live in a season where we often demean and disrespect the office of the man of God. But when this woman
preacher
had an issue, she had to call Reverend Elisha. I know we say stuff like this. The preacher, the pastor, he's a man just like I am. He puts on his pants one day at a time just like I do. He does, but there's a difference. God has set him aside to give a word for your life and to give vision to the household of God. And this is the word. Don't miss your blessing because you don't like God's wrapping paper. What God has for them, because they are too concerned with the wrapping paper that the man of God is in. But I tell you, I made up in my mind, any way you bless me, Lord, I'll be satisfied. When you're in a tough place,
preach, boy,
you have to look for people who have a word of experience. God speaks to us in various ways, and I don't have time to delineate. He speaks to us through his word, through circumstances, those who've been endowed with spiritual knowledge. The prophet speaks to her, and he has an inquiry. He says, what do you have in your house? I want you to investigate your personal resources. What do you have? In essence, what do you possibly have to contribute to eliminate some of the burdens you have? That's the question tonight. I know you're in a tough place.
Come on, Doc.
But that's what right. Do you have in your house?
Come on, Doc.
Listen
Come on.
To the tone of the woman. She speaks almost in a condescending and demeaning way. All I have, Reverend, is a little jar of oil.
Talk, Doc.
We sound like this woman. This must be our first cousin. When life gets hard, we start thinking what we have is not enough.
Preach, man.
You start thinking of what you have as if it's nothing. When life is tough, you start thinking just because the marriage has hit one tough spot, you start acting like the marriage has never been fulfilling. Just because things are tough on your job, you act like the job has not provided for you. When friends, when you hit a rough patch in life, you start treating your friends as if they are foes. Zechariah 4 and 10 teaches us not to despise small beginnings. And the Bible tells us, blessed is he who has believed and not seen. What do you have?
Come on, hear him.
In your house. Then the man of God tells her to invest in an unusual way. He says, go borrow. Wait a minute. There's tension there tonight. Lean in. He says, go borrow. borrowing is what got this woman in this position in the first place. Go borrow. This is what placed her in this vulnerable predicament. The woman is called to operate in faith, and trusting God often requires us to do the unimaginable. Can I tell you something now? When you have to do the unimaginable, you have to set your pride aside. Look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, when you're in a tough spot, you have to set your pride aside. That's not the time to talk about who you know. That's not the time to talk about that you're a supervisor and you know this person and that person. You have to do the unimaginable. But not only do you have to do the unimaginable, but sometimes you have to do the unsophisticated. Oh yes, when you're in a tough place, sometimes you have to do what you've never done in order to get what you never had. Look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, sometimes you have to do the unsophisticated, and sometimes you have to do the unpopular. You have to reject your purposes in order to receive the unrestricted. Notice God calls this woman. Man of God calls her to tap into her entrepreneurial spirit.
Speak, man.
When her circumstances would justify her simply being a victim. The word is, even in hard moments, God is always calling us.
Come on, Reverend.
To do better. Come on, to be Reverend. Better. Wait a minute. I know. When you go through trials, you think that's an excuse not to do. But let me tell you, when you're in a tough spot, you can't afford to sit down. You can't afford not to do anything. God is still expecting you to be your best self. Look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, when you're in a tough spot, that's not the time to get lazy. You got to get up in the morning with a determination that says, I can do all things through Christ that strengthens me. I am the head and not the tail. I am above and not beneath. You got to get up in the mirror and grab yourself by the collar and say, great is he that is in me than he that is within the world. I'm done tonight. I got to let you go. But also, you have to be willing to retire in solitude. God instructed this widow woman who has a woman dead on her head to borrow jars. Let the church say, borrow jars.
Borrow jars.
He says, go borrow some jars, and you and your son,
go ahead, Reverend.
Go in, sons, and go in and shut the door. God instructs her to utilize the assistance of others. However, they cannot have access to the scene of her miracle. Don't miss this. Some miracles cause others to assist and not see.
Come on,
there are miracles that God may desire to work in your life that requires public assistance, yet it forbids public viewing. Let me put it down your road. There are some blessings that God says they are for your eyes only. And you have to check what type of people that you have in your circle. Can they be happy helping you to get the miracle without experiencing the miracle? Can they put in a word for you at the bank without trying to get a kickback? Can they push you forward into the spotlight without trying to hold the spotlight? Sometimes God says, this miracle is for your eyes only. Jars. They open up an olive oil company in the front room of the house. As long as this woman has jars, the oil flows.
Oil. Yeah, talk about that oil, Doc.
When the jars ran out, the oil ceased.
The oil ceased.
Oil in this text represents the favor of the Spirit of God. God is not in the habit of sending blessings to people who don't have a container to secure. That's what I came to tell you tonight, Brother Shubai. God can do whatever you can imagine. But the question is tonight, do you have a container to receive what God wants to do in this ministry? Often we want blessings, but we have inadequate containers. Sometimes we have the inadequate container of a bad attitude. Sometimes we have the inadequate container of lack of discipline. Sometimes we want God to give us blessings, but we don't even have a devotional life. God says, I got blessings. I don't have a shortage of blessings, but do you have a container to receive it? I'm not in the business of wasting blessings. You have to receive the miracle and the midst of your misery.